Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Welcome and Housekeeping presentation, Jesus welcomes the participants to the assistance group and outlines the general plan for the program, along with providing some general principles for the participants to follow. Recorded on the 20th of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Well, here we go. For many of you, another one down. Another one begins. Yeah. Well, I think pretty much everyone is here, are they? There's two to come, is there? Yeah. Well, we might just wait a few minutes since still 7 minutes to go, really. And maybe what I should do is change the program to start at 6:30 or something, because everyone seems to be here early enough. Would you like to do that next time?
Yeah.
6 or 6:30, which one would you prefer? 6:30, good-o. Yep, so I'll make that little note and we'll do that next time, do it at 6:30 rather than 7 o'clock. Yeah. I suppose most of you travel, if you're going to travel, you travel today anyway. A few overseas visitors, up with your hands please, up overseas visitors, yeah. Sweden, USA, Canada. So, welcome. Yeah. It's a long way to come. And then there's a mixture of us, isn't there, from all... Is there anyone from the west of Australia? No. Wow. No, I mean, not originally, I mean. No, we're all from the east of Australia. Well, I haven't seen some of your faces for a while. Good to see you again. And those of you who were here last group, well, you know sort of what to expect, sort of. Just different material this time, that's all. Yeah. Well, the purpose of tonight is obviously just to welcome you to the program and to give you a bit of an introduction. How many of you haven't been to the session here before? So there's just a few, isn't there? Oh, it's probably 10 or 15. So we'll say the same things as we said the first time with a few embellishments, because there was a few unruly people last time, which we'll address this time through the introduction and welcome part of this session. But it's lovely to see you here again. And how have you been going experimenting with the use of your will? Have you even had isn't it interesting how we present the program and then you go home and then you realise that probably got to listen to it again, because you probably didn't get most of it when you were there. And so you listen to it again, and by the time you've listened to it again, another program's there and you haven't had time to practice it. So for most of you, I feel that you haven't had that chance to practice the use of your will very much. And this is an issue we're going to raise with you. We'll probably change the program around a bit so that we can help you apply some of the material, rather than just hammer you with a new thing and a new thing and a new thing, and you feel like you become overwhelmed eventually. So what we're going to do is still do the three programs this year, but it looks like, and we'll discuss with you at the close of these sessions, what we're going to do next year. But at this stage, we're sort of favouring just doing a whole series of 8 hours of Q&A on each hour of presentation this year. Just to help you and address some of your questions more fully. And that hopefully means that sort of over the 2 years you have a chance to apply the material that you've learnt this year, rather than just sort of forget about it or you know, be presented with a whole new group of material when you have yet to have really had a chance to apply the last bit of material. And this program and the one in November is going to be, particularly one in November, is going to be quite technical, and quite interesting for many of you, but to experiment with it will take quite a lot of your time, and so that's why I feel we're probably going to need a bit of that time next year to do that. So that's what we're thinking of this stage, and if you have a think about that during the week as to what you would like to see happen in terms of how that fits in with you, and then give us some feedback about that at the end of the week, that'd be appreciated. The first thing we would like to do is thank you for paying for our accommodation and travel, and for Lena, Igor, myself, and because without you doing that, this wouldn't be happening. So we'd like to thank you for that. And we'd also, up the back, there's some donation boxes, and Corny's donation box will be up there when he gets around to it. And I think there'll be extra videographers that we're training. In this case, it's Eloisa this time who's doing it. And she's standing in for Kel, who's actually going to be a participant. And then Kelly is going to be doing it next week, standing in for Eloisa, who's going to be a participant. And they'll have a donation box at the back if you'd like to contribute to them. But as you know, in the videos, it's great to... Well, maybe it's not great to see your face. It depends on how you feel about it. But obviously, you've got an opportunity then to reflect upon the information we've presented. Which sort of brings me to just some care about those particular things. Last group, we had to remind many of you to use your microphone properly. So if I can maybe just have a microphone from one of those mics, thanks Nina. If I can just remind you that if you are going to ask questions, and I'm very tempted to say to you, if you're not going to ask questions, and I'm wondering why you're here, but anyway, if you're going to ask questions, always keep that mic up nice and close, okay? If you can't hear you very well, then I can't hear you very well, and we're not going to hear you very well in the mix either. So if you can just be very mindful of the microphone, that's very important. Last time, particularly in the second group, I had to keep reminding people, closer to the mic, and it becomes very interruptive to the program. So it's an act of love for you to remember that there's other people trying to listen to what you're saying, as well as me trying to listen, and sometimes I'm a bit deaf, so... Thanks. So if you can remember that. The second thing to remember is we've now got two cameras for the audience because we're struggling to get some shots. But if you can't see one of those two cameras when you've got your mic in your hand, then what we'd like you to do is stand up and ask a question. Now, for the majority of you, I think it's pretty much, we can get a view pretty much of most of you. There is just sort of lines across where the center cameras are, where it's difficult to sort of see you. So just be mindful of that. And if one of the camera operators is going like this at you, trying to get you to do this, then it means please stand up so that we can get you in the shot. That'd be great. Yeah. And it's also handy if the person who's in front of the other person is not just moving in front of them, you know, it'd be good to move out of the way a little. That way we get a shot and the presentation then, when it goes on YouTube, is quite easy to follow, and we don't have to show audience shots all the time when persons are asking questions if we can't get you. So that'd be good. And it's just care for the event itself and what's going to happen afterwards. The whole reason why we're doing these presentations really is so that we can not only help and assist yourself, but also help and assist people who finish up watching the entire event. Now, at the moment, there's over 4,000 people who do that on a regular basis. So, you know, you by participating and also, you know, being aware of what's going on, you're actually assisting those people as well to be a part of the event, even though they can't make it here. Okay, then there's care of me. Last time I thought you did pretty good at that, with a few exceptions, which we'll talk about, but I feel as long as I can get my time, you're going to have just me again with this particular presentation. Mary's not going to be here till probably the last day. And so that means that I'm talking for 5 to 6 hours every day. And after I've talked for 5 or 6 hours every day, I don't really feel like talking much more than that. And so if you can just bear that in mind and give me my private time, that'd be fantastic. I know it's sometimes difficult because there's all these questions you might have, but if I don't last the distance, then you won't get to the end. So it's important that I last the distance. And last time there was a little bit of unloving behaviour towards Igor and Lena in particular, and I didn't know about it. I've asked them to tell me about it in future, but I'm not going to allow that either. So please just be aware that myself, Cornelius, Eloisa, Lena and Igor, all donating time to you as a gift in these sessions. And we're here to serve you, but we're not here to be downtrodden by you or anything like that. Our view of service is not that we get abused, and so we're not going to allow that to occur. Now, I feel most of you are pretty good with that last time. There were just a few exceptions that we'd like. And when I get the opportunity, I'll talk to the exceptions. Okay, so those are the main things about the logistics. Oh, there's one other thing, and that is, who's staying here? How many of you are staying here? So quite a number. Okay. Last time, those of you who are staying here, many of you took the water from here back to your rooms, and the water was being provided, you didn't know this, but the water was being provided free by the venue, which is now not being provided free because of your actions. And so what happens now is we pay for the water, and we would like you to consider, like, the fact that that's happened is really because of some unloving behaviour on the part of people who were taking water back to their rooms rather than buying water. Does that make sense? So it's an interesting issue, isn't it? An issue of love, a lesson in love. When something is given to us for free, what do we have a tendency to do? We have a tendency to abuse it. Yeah, we have a tendency to overuse it. It's like, have you ever been to a $5 pizza place or something like that? What have you noticed? Everybody overeats, right? Because something that's available for cheap, instead of just having a normal meal, most people are induced into gluttony, actually, as a result of it being offered for a cheap price or for free. And that's an issue of love, isn't it, really, if you think about it? Can you see the issue of love there? Yeah. You know, a person who loves other people doesn't do that, but a person also who loves resources doesn't overuse resources or abuse themselves overusing resources. So. And quite frequently at our events, things are provided for free only to be abused, and then we've got to remove those things because they're being abused rather than actually being treated as a gift that people would just use if they had a feeling of love, would just use in a normal manner. So that's the reason why that's happened. But so if you can just be mindful of that, the water's here for you to use while you're at the event, but not here for the rest of your day. If you can buy your own water, that'd be fantastic. That applies to us as well. We buy our own water and everything. So we would like that to apply to the group as well. Bearing in mind that no matter how much water you use, you donate the funds for it anyway. So in the end, you probably pay for it. But it's just the venue offered the water for free initially, and now they won't because of the action, which we needed to point out to you. Okay. Are there any questions that you guys have about sort of the general program? Because the program is much the same as it was last time, with one exception, and that is we have a 30-minute lunch break, which I think most of you will appreciate. Yeah, I think most of you felt the 20-minute was a bit short, and so we've turned it into a 30-minute break. So basically the day, each session is 2 days, and then we have a day break. So the first 2 day sessions, tomorrow and Sunday, the first day of any session always starts at 10:30, And the second day of any session starts at 11. And the first day we have 5 presentations on the average, and the second day we have 4. And it's a bit shorter day on the second day. And usually that's helped quite a lot, hasn't it? Because by the time the second day comes along of those 2 sessions, we're usually getting a bit overwhelmed with material and information and need a bit of time to digest. So that's the reason why we've designed it that way. So the program is exactly the same as it was last time, with that one exception of the lunch period being 1 half-hour long instead of 20 minutes long. Other than that, we're breaking every hour for 10 minutes. And so you've got the chance to go to the toilet and so forth and try to get out of here and just get your head wide again, if that's what you need to do, and then come back to the session. So what I would like to ask, though, is that you please come back on time. And particularly in the second group last time, I was waiting quite a lot for people to come back. And in the end, it just eats into the time of the day, and it just makes the day longer and longer. And so what we'd like to do is try to stick to that time frame with the 10 minute breaks. With the toilets, it's about to go out and around the side, and then you come in from the side, and the toilets are over on this side of our auditorium, but you go around the outside and around through the cafe area and into the toilets. And there are also extra toilets if you walk to the left, near to where the bouncing mat is. You'll find there's 2 extra toilets there. So for you ladies, instead of having a line up here, you could also sort of go over to there as well if you wanted to, so that way there's more toilets available to you for that break. You'll notice this group's a little smaller than last group that you had. That's because there's a bit of an imbalance in the groups this time. We've got close to 70 in the 69, I think it is, in the next group. So we're pretty full in the next group. And this group's 51. So there's quite a few less in this group compared to the next group. So this gives you great opportunity to have a bit more time to ask questions and so forth. Now, we want to handle the microphone running the same way as we did last time, which was, remember, that we basically would like each person to at least do it once. And in this case of this group, there's going to need to be some of you that do it twice, unfortunately. But if we can do at least once, then that means that every person who's involved in the microphone running is only really out of action for 1 hour of the group. And that, I think, is the most fairest way we can handle that particular thing. All right, now there's some things I think Mary's written down. She wanted to say to you just a few things. She wanted to say, number one, be brave. All right, in other words, engage by, you know, sharing in the program. And those of you who didn't speak up last time, think about that as to why and engage the program a bit more. And what else did she say to me? I just got off the phone with her just earlier. I can't remember the other 2 things she said now. Anyway, I'm sure they'll come up at some point. Now, the programs, by the way, you'll see them posted on the front door. So if you are in question about when we're starting, the programs will tell you when we're starting. Most of you would have seen them as a download from the internet anyway. The personal feedback sessions, we will still be having them. There will only be 2 times in the program. And the same sort of arrangement, if I do choose you, then I need you to be here a few minutes earlier with the mic, so that we can just help you with the mic, and we just will set up the video cameras a certain way if you're up the front. But it might be that we finish up doing ones from the audience again. It just depends on how many there are and how thorough I wish to be at the time with answering certain or giving certain feedback. So there's also the music program. How did you like Fab and Kate doing that today? Yeah? They're not getting enough donation to even pay for their travel at this point, so I'd just like to say that as a general comment. But they've volunteered to do that. And there will be a program, and this group will be one Monday as well. There will be a program Monday starting at 3 o'clock. But there will be no program Thursday, this group. But the next group gets free. It's just the way it's turned out. All right. Now, I think they're the most of the things. So I'll just check my notes here as to what other things needed to be mentioned. Yeah. Now, the biggest thing I'd like to discuss with you is this issue of asking questions. I don't know if you've had a look at the outline for the Welcome and Housekeeping, but there's a whole section in there about asking questions. What I found last time was that, man, you guys are still not good at asking questions. Tell stories, and in fact, Mary's done this for me so that I can not have to say it. And if you're not getting to the point, what's the question? And if you're just in an addiction with me, wanting daddy to listen to you, that's what you're going to get. So they're all there. Hopefully I don't have to use them. Don't feel too embarrassed if I do. Just be reflective and we'll get right. The issue with questions is interesting, isn't it? Because quite often we don't just get to the point of the question. We're wanting to tell a whole story and we're not reflective about what's the reason, the addiction-based reasons why we're wanting to tell the whole story rather than just ask the question. And I feel for a lot of you, it's a bit still about wanting daddy to approve of you or wanting daddy to understand you or listen to you. And in this role, I'm your daddy, apparently. And honestly, I don't feel old enough to be your daddy. Even though I am 2,000 years old, I'm still your brother. I'm your brother, right? And being your brother, it's not my role to do all of those things with you, is it? And in fact, if we consider the addictions involved, really it's not anybody's role to engage with your addictions. So I feel it's really important to address this issue of questions. A person who has a seeking heart wants to ask questions. So asking questions is a key part of seeking from your heart. But when you ask questions with no desire to listen to the answer, that tells me that all you're doing is telling me a story that you just want me to agree with. And that's not a question. And it's not even a seeking heart, because a seeking heart wouldn't do that. All right? So if you have a look at the outline that I've prepared for this particular session, on the section of questions, which is section 7, if you go down to that point, if those of you have the outline, this is what I've recommended for you. Number one, be a student. Don't be afraid to just put up your hand and say, I don't know what in the hell you're talking about. Don't be afraid to say, look, I don't understand what you're getting at there. Don't be afraid to speak up, right? I love this kind of engagement with you, particularly in the Q&As. That's the point of the Q&As, to enable you to ask any questions of some things you don't understand. So be a student. Student wants to learn, not put their stamp on things, not put their mark on things, not tell their whole story and use this as a forum to get other people's emotions from other people. It's not this forum. And I would like to have that stop, because that happened quite a lot in the first groups. And I've said, your first sentence should end with a question mark. That's a question. Now, if I'm a bit confused about your question, I'll ask you. I'll say, look, I'm a bit confused. Can you give a bit more detail about what you mean? That's fine. Now, in most cases, I know many of you have known you for a long time now. And those of you who I don't know or I don't, I can feel you anyway. So most of the time I know what you're trying to ask me, right? But I don't need the story. And quite often the story is masking the addiction that prevents the answer being given anyway. So quite often telling the story actually finishes up causing you to shut down to the potential of an answer. So that's not helpful. I've said be diligent in finding your questions. Prepare your questions beforehand. So this is why we've produced the outlines for you. The outlines are the material that we're going to cover. Now, what I suggest to you is this. In the morning, it's quite a bit of time in the morning, isn't it? It's from, I don't know when you wake up, but it's still pretty light at 6 a.m. and that's usually when I'm up or earlier. But if you're up at 7 or whatever, there's still plenty of time to sit down with the outlines. Look at one of the two or three outlines for the day. In most cases, there's only two or three outlines for the whole day. I'm not talking about the Q&A part of the outline. I'm just talking about just the presentation part of the outline. Look at that outline. Think about it a bit and ask yourself what questions you have about that you can think of even before you go along to the group. And then when you're here at the group, whack up your hand and ask those questions. So this is a great way for you to engage a bit more with asking what I would classify as pointed questions, which are very, very good. Now, if I can give an example, about the only person I could think of in the last group who asked really good questions was Graham. I don't know if you've seen the recordings, but Graham Sutherland asked some very good questions. Very straightforward, pointed. He was reflective about the answers, and when we engaged further, he even demonstrated that reflection through his comments. Does that make sense? And that was a very good example of questions that were asked with the right intention and with the right motivation. Yep. Now, I'd like to point out that most questions that were asked were selfish. In other words, it was all about your own day-to-day life. While I'm okay answering some of those things, because frequently other people have similar issues, sometimes you've got to question, like, it's better to ask a question that can solve lots of your day-to-day life problems than to ask a question that only solves one of your current pains. And bear in mind that your current pains, as we learnt in the first group, are the result of the resistance to the truth. It's a result of sin, really, isn't it? The result of the desire to sin. And so if you're feeling physical pain, it's already an indication that you're quite resistive to finding the answer. Right? And so asking a question about it often doesn't help you because you're already resistive emotionally to listening to the answer. Right? So this is where I'd like you to be a bit more reflective. I'm not saying don't ask those kind of questions, but I am saying be more reflective about, is this just a physical pain that's come up now, or is this something that's been long-term in your life, or is this something that you know and recognise is something in everybody's life? Because obviously I'd like to answer the questions primarily that focus on everybody's life more than I'd like to answer the question that focus on one person's life, for obvious reasons, because you can help solve many persons' problems at once if you do it the first way. So that's something I'd like you to bear in mind. I've said most questions were personal stories. So, you know, like talk for 2 minutes before the question mark sentence comes. And even then, many of you didn't even ask a question. You made a statement, right? And honestly, many times, some of you, like, I feel many of your statements are made because that's your opinion that you would like to express, but it doesn't really formulate a question. So I would like to see you formulate a question when you ask questions. A lot of questions are off topic. So we were doing like a Q&A on emotion and you're asking about truth or something. So stay on topic. It's a lot more helpful for the listener, particularly the person who's coming after you, you know, listening on YouTube, for all of us to stay on topic. because that way they learn the most about that particular topic rather than getting off being. Now, this is an issue that I wanted to raise. Most questions were asked without any intention of listening to or absorbing the answer. And it was evident that most questioners were thinking about what they wanted me to listen to rather than actually listening to the answer. Many of you even attempted to engage an argument with me about the answer. Right? And honestly, I don't give my time for free to have an argument with people. If I feel that you're not listening to the question, my feelings are I should just move on to the next person. You're allowed to choose to not listen to my answer, but I'm also allowed to choose to not give it. Isn't that right? Yeah. So I would like you to bear that in mind in future. Most don't allow me to be thorough enough answering your question because you're already engaged in, you're thinking that I don't understand fully what you've asked me when I am actually attempting to pinpoint the exact emotion that is driving you. And because you don't agree with that emotion, right, you want to say more to try to get me to that. No, it's not that, it's not that, it's this, it's this. Now, if you already knew what it was, why are you asking a question? So I'm assuming that if you ask a question, it means that you don't know what it is and you want something, some help to find out what it is. And if you want some help to find out what it is, and I can tell you what it is, but you can't listen to the answer, then isn't it pointless, the whole process? So what I'd like you to do is allow me to answer your question. Give me the time to answer your question. One of the reasons why I speak too fast is because I can feel you trying to jump in before I'm finished saying what I need to say. So I'm going to slow down. But as soon as you jump in, I'm going to go to the next person. That's what I've decided to do. All right? So don't be offended if I do it. Just realize that one of these problems has happened and I've moved on. All right? Now, one thing I'd like to address with you, though, is that most of the questions that I answered last time were emotionally rejected. Now, there's a difference between just sitting there and nodding your head and listening to an answer that I give you and actually absorbing the answer that I've given you into your heart. Now, this is where I felt, again, Graham did a great job of demonstrating that, right? Because he pondered about what was being said in return, then he had some realizations which he could reflect. And that allowed him to come to some conclusions that he didn't come to before because he allowed the process to continue. Right. Now, not many do that. Most are rejecting the information as it's coming to you, and particularly the questions as they're coming to you. And in fact, the motive of asking questions for many of you has been either one of those few things, like getting Daddy's approval or getting Daddy to agree with you or getting Daddy to think that, yeah, you've done the right thing, isn't it wonderful? You just work that out, when quite frequently I can't agree. Right? And those kind of motivations are not going to be helpful for your progress. They're just not. Now, some of the questions last time had so much, I'll just put this down, had so much errors in the question that I've got to interrupt you at every single moment there's an error. Now, I'm very mindful. The reason why I do that is I'm very mindful that this information is getting put on YouTube for thousands of people to watch. And every time you make a statement that's out of harmony with truth or out of harmony with love, it's my responsibility to correct it. Does that make sense? And if I don't correct it, then that statement might be assumed by an audience to then be something that I agree with. And I can't agree with it You follow? So this is one reason why many of you get a bit annoyed with me, right? Because I'm interrupting you while you're asking a question, trying to correct the actual statements that you're making as you're making them, each statement in error being made. Allow that process to happen. Does that make sense? And it's not only good for you, but it's also good for the people who are listening. Because the people who are listening have an opportunity to actually ponder about, wow, that's what I thought, and yet, like, Jesus is saying something else about that, right? And it allows people to get some context as well. Now, I'm very, very mindful of the context. Like, historically, I've been quoted very much out of context, which has caused, as you can see from, for instance, the Christian faith, has caused generations of problems. So I'm very mindful of that, of that happening. So if we get in a dialogue where you're asking a question, I'm going, hang on a sec, we need to stop here and we need to just discuss that point first and then move on, and we have this sort of back and forth dialogue, engage that process with me rather than getting impatient with it, because you'll learn a lot in that process. Does that make sense? Yeah. Don't be afraid to engage it. It's okay with me. But it's great. It's great for your learning, but also for other people's learning. So remember, we're here because we want to learn about love, right? That's what it's all about. This Education in Love series is all about wanting to learn more about love. Now, let's just cast your mind back to the last group, because all of you should have had an opportunity to watch the last group now. The key part of that was developing your will to love. Now, I feel for many that you've yet had the chance to really experiment with that, to experiment with how you're using your will. And in particular, how you're using your will either to love or not in harmony with love. And put the problem with this week's presentation is that we're now adding a whole heap of new material to that, right? So we're going to be building on that, in fact, building on the exercise of your will. Now, you can see we've done a diagram, which is actually in your outline notes. This one's not as pretty because I didn't want it to be pretty. I specifically asked Eloisa not to make it pretty because the colouring that I used in the notes, the progression towards darkness, was a bit hard to put on a white board, right? So, but this is like the progression towards darkness is really, you could explain it as. And this board is basically what we're going to be discussing for the next four days of presentations. All right, so have a look at that little diagram if you've got it there in your notes. And reflect upon it. That's really what we're going to be spending a fair bit of our time trying to understand, what's really happening to us inside of ourselves, you know, what's going on inside of ourselves. But you notice there's also a column over here we'd talk about, which I've now interrupted I'm already rubbing out my own whiteboard, which is all about will. So this is trying to help you tie what's happening here in your life to how you're exercising your will in your life. Does that make sense? So what we're trying to do in this program is build on what you've learned in the last session and to see how the application of your will in a sinful direction has caused many problems and how you can undo that process. That's our focus. Now, for that to occur, for this engagement of this material to occur, I would like to have engagement with you. Now, that means all of you. So instead of there just being a few people who regularly engage, what I would like to see is that most of you regularly engage. Open up to the question process, open up to understanding the material. Now, there's a part of your processing is dealing with the intellectual blockages to understanding material. And then the part of your processing is the emotional side of the material. What I would like it to achieve at least is to break down some of those intellectual blockages at least, so that we can at least understand the material enough to apply it. All right. Obviously, it would be very helpful if we can also undo the emotional blockages, because that's where we actually heal, that's where we change. But even if we come away understanding things better, understanding our life better, that is a large part of this goal. Tomorrow morning, I'll be introducing the topics of what we'll be discussing during the week. And what I would like you to do in that introductory discussion is to think about, and you can do this already before the discussion, is to think about why have we programmed this sort of this 240-hour program, why have we done it where the very first thing that we've discussed is will, and the very next thing that we've discussed is our intention to be our loving self? Why have we done it that way? If this is all about gaining an education from God, why is this so important? Why are these first two groups focused on those two subjects? The will, our personal will, and also our self, the development of our self. And what I'd like you to do is ponder that question. And even tomorrow, if you want to ask some questions about that, that's fine. But at least ponder that question as to why we've done it that way. Now, remember, we're here really to receive an education from God, not from Jesus. All right, so you're here to receive an education from God. All I'm trying to do is help you open up to God, help you open up to work out why it is that God's not already communicating with you and educating you, why it is that there is already blockages within us that prevent that education. That's all I'm trying to do here. And if you think about that in relation to the question I just asked as to what, why will first and self second, you'll see why we've developed the program the way that we have. So I'd like you to ponder about that in the morning. Allow yourself to have a think about how the program's been developed. We want to get to the stage where God is able to educate you directly. He has the ability to do so with every one of his children. And the only thing that stops us from getting educated directly is ourselves. That's the only thing that stops us. So what we've got to try to do is break down all the resistances we have to God's education, getting that education from God. We've got to break down that resistance. And the purpose of the first group was to help you see how to use your will. And the purpose of this group is to help you see how that will is affecting your choices and decisions and therefore your pain and suffering or your joy and happiness. And we'd like to spend a lot more time on that over the coming week. So that's going to be the focus of our program. Is there any questions you guys would like to ask you, Chris, if we come?
What the heck is an intellectual block?
An intellectual block I'd classify as, I'm not even going there. I'm not even going to look at that. I don't even believe that at all. So it's something where your emotional belief has constructed an intellectual construct that basically says you're not going to examine, you're not going to have an open mind on an issue at all. Now, all intellectual blockages are driven by emotions. So every time you decide inside of yourself that I can't believe that, that's, you know, I can't accept that, that is driven by something that's going on emotionally, right? But what I'm suggesting is we need to first open our minds before we can actually open our hearts. And for many of us, we're still refusing to open our minds, let alone our hearts. right? Now, if I can give you some examples. If a Christian, let's say a practicing Catholic came into the audience, that person would already have some very strong intellectual constructs, many of which that person doesn't agree with emotionally themselves, but they would have some strong intellectual constructs that prevent them from engaging the material. So if I can give an example, they'll come in and they'll say, right, Jesus should be performing miracles here, right? If he's not performing miracles, that's it. I can't listen to him. Well, that's an intellectual construct that has been driven by some personal belief systems, some of which are emotional and some of which are intellectual, that they're holding on to. And for the person who's a Christian, is holding on to a Bible, a book, which has told them these particular intellectual constructs. And if we asked a Muslim to come, there'd be a whole different layer of constructs. And if we had a Hindu here, there'd be a whole different layer of constructs. And what I'm suggesting is all of these constructs, to actually absorb truth, you need to be aware that every potential intellectual construct that you have engaged within yourself could be false. That's one of the first points of awareness that we need to meet, that every single one of them could be false. From God's perspective, every single one of them might be false. All right? And that you need to allow to occur. Now, if you can't intellectually allow that to occur, then it's highly unlikely you'll let any information touch your heart. And in fact, it's highly unlikely you'll even hear the information. Yep. So many of you have had to, even in listening to me over a few years, you've had to break down many of your intellectual constructs, haven't you? Even though you're yet to engage much of the material emotionally, you've had to actually break down, well, maybe that is possible, maybe that is possible. What proof do I have that it isn't? None. So I must accept that maybe it is. And these kind of constructs need to be broken down in order for us to begin absorbing information from God. If you think about it, if God's the knower of all truth and I know nothing, then obviously I need to be firstly aware that I know nothing or aware that I know very little. Now, I need to at least be intellectually aware that I know very little, even though emotionally I might not know the reasons why I'm blocking information. I need to at least be intellectually aware. Many of us are still not intellectually aware, and this is where we start blocking truth. We start blocking truth while it's being said to us because we can't allow the possibility, intellectually even, of that being true, right? And this is something we've got to deconstruct. Does it make sense? Yeah. So that's what I mean by the emotional, intellectual blockages and the emotional blockages. The deconstruction of the facade, we'll talk about the facade and its deconstruction in the group. The deconstruction of anything requires, firstly, what I would classify as a process of intellectual awareness, which is coming from a place of intellectual denial into an intellectual awakening. But that is not going to heal you. It's only going to begin to open you up to being healed. Does that make sense? It's the emotional process, the soul-based process that will heal you, but the soul-based process won't even occur if the intellectual process has not occurred. Yeah. And so this is where we need to be able to see things before we can process things. For many of us, that's the way it is. The reason why that is because as a child, we have been taught to put layer upon layer of illogical intellectual reasoning upon our emotions. So what we've done is we've stuffed down our emotions, what we really feel, by having layer and layer and layer and layer of intellectual so-called logic, but it's not very logical at all. But we have it presented to us by our society, by parents, and through our own life. And what we do is we've got all of these layers of belief systems that are all there to help us not access the emotion. That's the point of them. The point of them is help us to stay away from the emotion. Most religious belief systems are all about denial of emotion. Isn't that interesting? Most family belief systems are all about denial of emotion. You think about it. When the as a family, how much acceptance of emotion is in your family compared to how much denial of emotion is in your family? And most of the so-called logic that is used is all used for the point of suppression. Right? And so this is where we're going to struggle absorbing truth from God. If God's only form of communication with the human is soul to soul, emotional soul to soul communication, then can you see that if I'm not open soul to soul communication, I'm already blocked to receiving communication from God. Now I have to somehow unravel that. I need to undo that. The only way I can undo that is look at all of these layers of things that have been put on top of the underlying emotional condition that is in error. And as we'll see in our presentations over the coming few week, you'll see that the drive to prevent pain, and more importantly, the drive to prevent the fear, feeling the fear of pain, is actually so strong that it can cause so many problems for us, but it also causes us to construct a whole heap of illogical intellectual argument to support the suppression of the emotion. Now, if God's form of communication with you is emotional, soul to soul, then that is a huge problem. Right? Now, I put to you that no one has ever in history proven that God communicates in any other way other than soul to soul. You try to have an intellectual conversation with God and see how you go. Most of you can't hear a thing from God, right, under those circumstances. And the reason why is because God doesn't communicate that way at all. Right? He communicates soul to soul, feeling-based, emotional-based communication. And unless we learn how God communicates, and by the way, this is how the human was created to naturally communicate, right? So the little child knows more about soul-to-soul communication than adult does, because we've got all these layers of intellectual argument put on top of it. But unless we learn how God communicates, we're not going to receive an education from God. Then all we're going to do is finish up listening to other people about God. Now, haven't you had a gutful of that? Listening to somebody else, then you've got to go, well, maybe they're right, maybe they're wrong, I don't know. And so after you've heard maybe they're right, maybe they're wrong, and maybe that person's right, that person's wrong, maybe that person's right, then I don't know. After you've heard 20 of such people talking, you finish up closing down, don't you? You just go, oh, what's the point? Like, I don't know, and there's no way to determine whether what they're saying is true or not, so I'm just going to give up. That's what finishes up happening, right? But if you have specific communication with God, that will never happen. You are no longer reliant on what other people are telling you about God, because you can feel from God what God's telling you about God and what God's telling you about the universe. That is a much more reliable way of finding out truth. That is a much more reliable way of being educated. Right? So you can come here and hear me talk about God, or you can learn how to hear God. And what I'm the whole point of this program is to help you hear God. Right? Soul to soul communication with God. That's the point of the program. Right? Without that, there is really no. I'm just talking words, and you're just hearing words, and they might be right, they might be wrong. You don't know. Without you having some form of communication with God to get some form of agreement or disagreement with what's being said, you're not going to know. Right? It's just something to think about, or maybe that's an idea. It's just a concept. It's not real yet, and it can't be real. It can't be real until you have confirmation either through your day-to-day life in a reliable fashion. And that's why we're going to talk about law, because there is reliable, there's reliable laws that will, which will demonstrate. But without you getting some kind of feedback in a reliable fashion, you're not going to know the truth, and you're not going to discuss it or understand it or practice it. Can you see that? Yeah. So many of you, and we'll talk about this tomorrow too, many of you are waiting for a miracle. Then you'll know, you reckon. But you won't know. You won't know. You're only going to know through this communication with God at the end of the day. Right? So we want to talk more about that. Yeah, that's a good question. Any other questions? Thanks. At the back, where's the mic? Thanks.
I'm wondering, can you skip some of the intellectual stuff and go straight to the emotional sort of connection? Because I can be lazy with the intellectual stuff.
No, you can't, Paul. You can't. Many of you are trying to do that. But the problem is the intellectual arguments are there. You remember we said in the first presentation, in the first talk about will, we said that we want to deny, suppress our emotions. We want to deny, suppress the truth. We want to deny, suppress developing faith. So our mind just does what we want. Now, the only way we can unravel that is by seeing what the mind is constructing that's false, and saying, well, hang a sec, no, we've got to stop letting ourselves off the hook for all the false stuff we create. You follow? But to do that, we have to recognize what is false.
Yeah, that self-awareness and understanding our...
Yes.
Yeah, yep. What we're doing. Yep.
Yeah. And for many of us, we're yet to even engage that process many times. Like, for many of you, you don't understand why you enter a relationship with somebody. You don't understand what emotions are driving you, but you don't even understand what you're trying to get intellectually from this person, right? So it's important to do both things, Paul, not just one and ignore the other. Obviously, if you're a child who has very little blockages to emotion, it's going to be a lot easier for you to access your emotion instantly, as you say. But for an adult who's, you know, what's your age now, in the 50s?
Yeah, 51. Yeah,
51. And, you know, for an adult who's lived 50 years on earth, there's already quite a lot of layers of illogical intellectual layers, saying a whole heap of things that are not even true to ourselves, so that we want to believe them, so that we can avoid emotion. And we need to see what they are. Yep.
Thank you.
It's a part of the process. Obviously, we need to understand ourselves. And this, you know, we need to understand how we became our unloving self, but we also need to understand how we can develop our loving self. How did we become our unloving self? How did we become the person we are now? And then how can we develop the loving part of us? Like, how can we do that? To do that, you need to understand yourself. So the key part this week is learning to understand yourself. Right? So that's what we've been trying to help you with this week, help you to understand yourself. Yeah, the reasons why you do things. And the reasons why we feel pain, the reasons why we have suffering, the reasons why we create a facade, the reasons why we find it so hard to undo our facade. Like, what are the reasons? We need to understand ourselves better. If you understand yourself, you have an opportunity to get rid of the things that you've created. You remember, God's not going to get rid of those for you. They're your creations. God doesn't get rid of sin. God gets rid of the cause of sin if you desire to get rid of the cause. Right? But God doesn't get rid of the results of what you've chosen to do. You will have to go through those results. You need to understand that. Right? So these are very important things to understand. And hopefully we'll spend a bit of time, 30 hours this week, and hopefully we'll understand them ourselves a bit better at the end. Any sense? Yeah. Yep. Any other questions? Sis, down the front.
Jesus, is that where study comes in?
Well, when you know, in our first group, remember we said right at the beginning that the way humankind on earth learns is usually through, you know, going to school, learning a whole heap of things sort of in an intellectual way, isn't it? By rote sort of learning, studying, remembering, regurgitating, studying, remembering, regurgitating, and so forth. Well, that can help our development, because it obviously did help our development in terms of learning maths and learning science and learning English and or another language, if another language is your primary language, and so forth. But there's a whole heap of soul processes that needs to begin. And these soul processes are going to require much more than just an intellectual understanding. They're going to require a soul opening. But as I said to Chris, if intellectually we're in denial that that's even possible, then it's never going to happen. So both things need to happen. But I don't think study is so much more important as pondering over things, questioning things, analysing things. This is why I'd like you to engage more sort of analytical questions, if you like. But what's going on here? What's going on there? Understanding what's happening. Rather than just asking a question about your personal life and what's the emotion, understand better, like, what caused that emotion, what childhood events triggered those particular things, what beliefs do you have now as a result of it. Spend more time asking yourself about things. So this is what I do all the time for myself, right? I don't get all anal about it, in the sense of, you know, all judgmental and critical and all those kind of things, because that's unnecessary. And in fact, that's a major reason why these parts of our facade exist, because of other things we're doing with it. But we do need to understand ourselves better. So you could say, I suppose, in some ways, there's two things to study, if you're going to choose to study anything. Two things to study. Firstly, study God as much as you possibly can, you know. Second thing, study how God made you. And then if I'd add a third to that, I would add study God's laws. But studying them doesn't guarantee you know them. Knowing them requires engagement of them. Knowing them requires you going through an experience. And your willingness to do that is based upon emotion, not upon intellect. And it's not upon how much you study. You can study, you know, for the next 50 years and still not decide to go through the emotional experience. So it's going to require you knowing, but then doing. And doing is going to be emotional. It's not going to be intellectual. So I'm not adverse to studying or, you know, looking at information and those kind of things. What I'm suggesting is you've got to be able to put it into practice, and you've got to be able to put it into practice at a soul level, not at an intellectual level. You're used to, as all of us are on this planet, are used to engaging learning on an intellectual level and putting it at practice on an intellectual level. That's how we engage our learning generally. But that's not how it's going to work with God. That's why most of us don't communicate with God, because we've suppressed the ability to communicate with God soul to soul. We've suppressed the ability to engage learning at a soul level. And what we want to do is open that up. Does that make sense? Yeah. So studying is okay, but it's not going to be the answer to really getting things into our heart. we need to study, but it's not the main part, if you like. I feel the main part is first development of our will, which we talked about last time we got together. And then the second thing is learning how to analyze and develop yourself. Learning how to do that. How to undo all the things you've done. How to undo all of your own creations or the creations of others who have affected you. We need to understand how to do that at the soul level, which hopefully we'll help you with this week.
I'm remembering you saying that you spent a lot of your time going to emotional therapists in the beginning when you...
I wouldn't say a lot of my time, it was a couple of hours a week.
Sorry, some of your time.
Yep.
And then you spent, I think you said, most of the rest of the time writing about it.
That's I spent a lot of time in self-analysis, at being honest with myself. Remember the four things from the will session last time we got together? Developing the desire for truth, have some faith, wanting to take some action and dealing with emotion. They're going to be key things this week. They're going to be key things to help you this week. And obviously we're going to bring them up again because they are key parts of how you exercise your will. So it is one thing to get some help, quite another to learn how to do this for yourself. Yeah, and what I'm hoping to do is to teach you more about how to do it for yourself. Emotions aren't naturally flowing out of you because there are blockages inside of you preventing those emotions flowing out of you. There are choices you are making that prevent the flow of that emotion. We need to understand that and we need to undo that. That's our creation. God's not going to undo it for us. We need to undo that. Right?
Thank you.
Ben, just straight behind.
So can I sit here and agree with everything you say but still have intellectual things to unravel, or is it just choosing to apply and having that will develop to apply it? And
what I notice is this, Ben. Most people agree with what I say to other people, but they never agree with what I say about themselves. It's very rare to find a person who agrees with it about themselves. So what that tells me is that a person is like, it's like sitting in watching telly in some ways. You can observe it all going on somewhere else and distance yourself from the whole thing. That's what you can do. Many of you have done that for years with me. You've distanced yourself from what's being said, not applying it to yourself. The key for us to learn how to have a connection with God, we need to unravel all the things inside of ourselves that prevent that connection with God. That's what we need to do. The only way we're going to do that is by being a lot more, you know, with a lot more what I'd classify as honest, truthful self-examination of my true feelings. Now, that requires some effort because there's obviously going to be a lot of things inside of us that are already saying, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that. There's a whole lot of pain that might come up. There's a whole lot of bad experiences that might happen. Don't do that. And we're going to have to be brave enough to overcome those particular feelings, as well as at the same time be willing to go through that process of undoing all of our own creations. Now, we can sit and listen, and many of you do sit and listen and agree with a lot of what I say. In fact, many of you like what you hear a lot of the times. That's why you listen. But when it comes to actually doing, many of us don't do anything. And we've got to break this barrier between listening to everything and doing very little or nothing into listening to everything and applying it. That's what we've got to do if we're ever going to deconstruct this process that we've got with God, where it's all, we've still got our barriers with God. So I would suggest that it's one thing to come and listen and agree or disagree as your will is engaged. It's quite another to actually put it into practice. I don't see a large number of people putting it into practice. I really don't. And in fact, I feel like I count in the world on my hands the number of people who are actually putting it into practice. That's how few are putting it into practice. Now, Now, I'm talking about people who are putting into practice every moment of every day of their life, which is what you're going to need to do. In the first century, that's why I called this the way, or God's way, because it's the way to live your entire life. It's not just something to listen to occasionally.
And when it gets put into practice, you're not actually doing it because it's just happening?
Yeah, well, once you release from yourself the you could say the consequences of your unloving prior choices and the causes of why you made those unloving prior choices and the consequences of other people's unloving prior choices imposed upon you and the reasons why they made those particular choices, once you've released all of that, you now have the freedom to choose what you're going to do with the rest of your life. You're sort of in some ways like a newborn babe ready to experience life, but you're still going to have to make a choice, you see. So many of you sort of believe that the reason why you sin is because mankind for centuries have sinned and they've just passed down the sin onto you. That's only one part of why you sin. The other part of why you sin is actually the will-based choices you personally are making to sin. And these are the most difficult to give up.
So it just gets easier as you...
As you deconstruct the reasons why you engage the sin, as you deconstruct that, you have less and less imperative, less and less drive to engage sin. And in fact, after a while, sin becomes so difficult for you to engage that you can't do it. Right?
And the good things, because I find it quite difficult to do even good things, but that all becomes easier as you go through that process.
Again, if you've developed your will for that to occur, you see, most of us don't engage good things because we have deep fears associated with doing it that we do not understand. And this is why we need to have a whole discussion about understanding ourselves, because we need to understand why it is that we don't have a strong desire to engage good things. And if you examine what's happened in our childhoods and so forth, many of us can see, can't we, that whenever sometimes we did good things and got punished for them. So that's obviously one reason why we don't engage good things or we're afraid of them. But there are many reasons why. Some of it is we're afraid of being in the spotlight. We're afraid of people noticing us. We're afraid of being the best person we can be. Many of you are like that. You're willing to be an audience member. See, I'd like all of you to be willing to be the presenter.
Thanks.
Yeah. You imagine if we had 4,000 presenters of God's truth rather than 4,000 audience members of God's truth. Do you think there'd be 4,000 after that? 4,000 people listening? It'd be potentially like 400,000 people listening, wouldn't there? And if all of those people became presenters of God's truth rather than audience members, you can see that within a very short period of time, God's truth would be well known around the world, would it not? If that was engaged, that process. So this is why it's very important for us to understand that we need to work through, we need to desire using our will. Only you can do this. Nobody else can do it for you. I need to choose to desire to use my will to undo all of the creations of my sin, undo all of my unloving self, become my loving self, and then engage that in the world and to use my will to do that. Yeah. And that means my whole life. That means like if my job's out of harmony with love, I change it, or I develop a new one that's in harmony with love. If my, you know, relationship's out of harmony with love, I change it. If anything in my life is out of harmony with love, I change it. And you can see for many of us, that just makes us feel terribly frightened. Right, because we look at it and we go, oh, but that means I'll have to change that and I'll have to change that and this will change and that will change. And remember, we discussed in the first group how afraid we are of change. We're petrified of it. For many of us, that's why we're content to be an audience listener rather than a person who's actually presenting God's truth, because they can hear it from God. And all of you have the opportunity to do that. There's no, God is not impartial. God is not impartial. God is impartial. Sorry, too many negatives there. God is impartial. God feels the same way about all of God's children. You are just as precious to God as any other. God feels that you have just as much to share with others as any other. You have just as much ability to educate others as any other. But it all depends on whether you've received the education from God already or not, doesn't it? Can you see that? It just depends on that. So if you're not receiving an education from God, how can you then share or educate, help educate others? You can't, really. So for many of us, the reason why we're not engaging is because we know that we're not receiving education from God and we're not engaging doing that, and therefore we're not sharing that what we know with others, because we can't really say ourselves that we really know it yet. It's very interesting, the people I feel who are actually, those few people I can count my hands, that I feel who are actually engaging God's truth in that way, have all created something. All of them have created something. Something they do every week, every day for many of them. They engage a process, you know, which is something all of us can do. But we don't. And there's got to be reasons why. And I'm saying one of the reasons why is because we're not convinced. We listen, but because we haven't fully engaged the process ourselves, listening to God, we're not convinced. So we don't engage the education of what we've learnt with others because we've yet to learn. So it's good that we haven't. There's no good engaging the education of others when we don't know ourselves. And that's something I'll discuss with you in the morning. But it is something to ponder about, isn't it? We want to gain this education ourselves, get to the position where we are able to we are an eternal student, but in the process of being an eternal student, we now have learnt enough to share with others what we've learnt. That's what we need to do. In the Bible, it talks about me saying that to my disciples. I encouraged them to go out and preach. Have you ever heard that statement? Yeah. What do you reckon that meant? They learnt something and they were to share it with others. Every person who sincerely learns God's truth eventually shares that same truth, you know, with others. And once we've learnt God's truth, we'll all agree. And the more of God's truth we learn, the more subjects we'll agree on. Because we're not holding on to our own opinions anymore. We're only interested in what God's truth about that matter is. So at the moment, you ask 7 billion people what they think about things and everyone's got a different opinion. And that's because none of us are connected, or very few of us are connected to God to know what God's opinion is. So that's our goal, huh? Part of our goal is to do that. So to do that, we need to understand ourselves much better so that we can begin this emotional exchange with God. That's our purpose here. We want to work out all the things that are stopping our emotional exchange with God, our soul-based exchange with God. Once you have the soul-based exchange with God, you have the ability to absorb God's truth from God, and that's what you need. That's going to be the main point of your education, in fact. And God's got far more to share with you than anyone else that you've ever met has got to share with you Of course, because God has an infinite wealth of knowledge. So to me it makes sense. You ask about any mathematical subject, God knows. You ask about any scientific subject, God knows. You ask about what's happened with human languages and all the human languages on earth, God knows them all. And you ask God about anything to do with the universe, how it works, well, God knows, God created it. You ask God about God's laws, God knows. Now, these are things that humans just don't know. God knows it all. So it makes sense that the main thing that we need to do is give up what we know and start focusing on trying to understand how God communicates with us so that we can know from God. To me, that's what makes sense. It's made sense ever since I was a child in the first century. That's what I had to do. And I'm suggesting that's what you need to do. And it's so much fun. It is so much fun. It's like, we get taught on earth so many things that are wrong. We do. Or they're just theories, you know, they're just ideas or concepts. We don't even know. You know, we still don't know what makes up an electron, really. You know, the basic building blocks of matter, protons, nucleus, and all those atomic structure and so forth. We've got no idea. But God knows. We don't know all the laws. In fact, we've barely scratched the surface of all of God's laws. But God knows them all. You know, mankind, the furthest humankind has travelled, you know, on earth is where? I mean, with a person, to the moon, right? God knows what's billions of light years away. And you can be informed about it. This is any information you want to know, human body. God knows everything about it, how it works, why it breaks down, why it gets ill, why it accepts disease, why it sometimes rejects disease. God knows everything. And doctors are still scratching their head about most of it, right? I've got no idea. Well, why is it we can take certain body parts out and the body still seems to survive? Why are those body parts there in the first place? There must be a reason, right? Well, God knows that too. You see, it's like, that's why I feel we need to focus on getting our education from God. So that's what we'll try to help you do this week. Just deconstruct the blockages. That's what we want to focus on. The next one, the first five groups of this course, if you like, this introduction to the education and love series stuff, is really all about breaking down your barriers to God, how to do it, how to do it using God's laws. You do that, now we have an opportunity to get some communication with God. Once we've got the communication with God happening, now we can start to grow, change, enjoy life, and also share what we know with others. Huh?
A lot of my desires to connect with God have been selfish desires. Mm-hmm. So are we going to cover some of that this week?
God doesn't listen to him, right?
I know. So I was just thinking about, well, because I like knowledge, and when you're talking about gaining all this knowledge, and I've contemplated it before, well, it'd be great to connect to God to get all of this knowledge, but that then is another selfish desire, isn't it?
I don't know if that's a selfish desire.
It's not. Okay.
Why would it be selfish?
Well,
I suppose you could make it selfish.
Yes, that's probably.
But it's like most desires, isn't it? You can make most of them can be made to be loving, and most of them can be made to be selfish, can't they? Depending on how we use them. So if you use knowledge to hurt people, or to put people down, big note yourself, or whatever, that obviously would be unloving. An unloving use of knowledge. If that's your desire, God's not going to share knowledge with you.
Yes. But if the desire is just is, wow, that knowledge would be great, and that encouraged me to connect with God, I'm feeling that selfish still.
Why?
Oh, okay.
If you connect to God, you'll be more loving. Therefore, everyone around you will feel the results of you being more loving. They'll all benefit. You'll benefit. See, this is the beauty of connecting with God, is that you benefit, but everyone else does too. When you're just selfish, you benefit and everyone else pays. Everyone else pays the penalty if you benefit. All right, there's a big difference there, isn't there? Yeah. So when we're in harmony with love, you benefit, you will personally benefit, but everyone else will too. When you do things out of harmony with love, you might think you benefit, right? But everyone else pays the penalty. And in fact, what happens eventually is you pay the penalty too. Right? So that's a big contrast between those.
Yeah, and maybe I'm thinking selfish wrongly, you know. Maybe that's where I'm getting a little bit mixed up by it.
Yeah, I feel sometimes we are, what's the word I'm looking for? We do a whole heap of very unloving things, justifying them as love. And then on the opposite side of the coin, we avoid a whole heap of loving things, justifying them as unloving. Do you see? And that, as we discussed in our first group, is because our whole viewpoint of love is completely warped. It's the world's definition of love. It's not God's. So unless we gain God's definition of love, and God's definition of love is very much around the fact that God wants everyone to benefit, not just you.
Yes, and I feel personally, if I had knowledge that was God's knowledge, I know I would share it. I wouldn't hold on to it, or I don't feel as if I would use it in a negative way.
Well, no, I can't agree with that, because you okay. use your current knowledge in a negative way. Sometimes you put down people, sometimes you use it to put down people, like make them feel worse about themselves and so forth. So God knows our motivations better than we do, right? And God's laws, in fact, all measure our motivations. So this is where we need to know ourselves better as to why we're not receiving information from God. God is not going to share things with you if God knows that you're going to use it poorly. If you're going to use it out of harmony with love, God's not going to share something with you. You're not ready yet, right, from God's perspective. Yeah. So what we need to do is desire to become ready. The way we do that is by learning to purify our motivations. But that requires understanding our unloving self and becoming our loving self. Yeah. And that's why we need to go through this process of seeing and examining our real motivations for doing things. Yeah. Yeah. The more pure our motivations become, the more God will share with you. The more God will share. Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay, well, sorry for my 20 minutes over time, guys. So I think I need to finish there. We'll discuss some of these things in the morning as well in our introduction to our course this week. But hopefully you've got a bit of an outline of what you can do, and also a bit of an idea of what you can do with those questions of yours. Like these questions you've asked today, nice. More reflective, right? Less stories. I haven't had to use one of these signs ever so far. So that's really good. And what we'd like to do is just make sure that we stay in that mode when we're asking our questions and thinking about these things. Hopefully you have a good night's sleep and come ready in the morning at 10:30. Glenda, you'd like to ask?
Are you updating hard drives?
I am. Yes, so if you have hard disk drives to update, just leave them up the back on the right-hand desk and I will pick them up each night, and depending on how many there are, I'll bring them back the next day.
Yeah. Also, right back in the beginning, you said on average a $200 donation would cover costs. And I heard something that that price had gone up.
Yes, what happened, we had, I'll explain, I have to put this on the website, but what happened is I didn't factor in all of our backup drives that we needed to store the data, and also we needed to purchase two more backup servers because the old ones weren't, when we come to edit the data, they weren't fast enough for us to do dual editing. And so we had to update those, and the cost of those things were, in total, were about $15,000. So that spread across the eight groups has put the cost at around $330 a group. Yep. And but as I've said, we've received enough donations to pay for. So actually, what happened is all of your donations, the last group, I spent on that stuff. Actually, So that's where all the money went from the donations you put in my box in the last group. And but that means now that we've got enough to last to the end of the year with all those things. So we've now paid for an X group. But yeah, the average price has just gone up, and it's just for your information more than anything else. Yeah, as a result of that. So it was the technological things that we encountered after the group that caused some of these issues. As you know, we collect 8 terabytes of data per group for the original group, and we store it 3 times. So 24 terabytes of data get stored from each group. The backup drives are around $400 each. So there's 3 of those. And then we've got the RAIDs that we use. And I had to go and buy special drives for those RAIDs, and they cost nearly $800 each, and there's 10 of them. So that is where the money went. Yeah, it all went on those things. But we've still got enough money to run the rest of the groups up until the end of this year. So as you know, if you donate, we'll always be able to use the funds doing something, we just were informing people that was the reason why the change. I've actually got on the website under assistance groups, there is a costing of all of those things there. You can see them if you want to see them. Yep. Any other questions you guys got? No? That's good. Well, have a good night's sleep, guys. See you bright and bushy. See you in the morning.